to Maggie. Good morning, everyone. I'm Herb Silverman. Thanks for coming early to a talk, and it'll be a terrific one as well. The topic listed in the program is secular activism in the courts. But for those who attended some of yesterday's sessions, you probably know it's really about sue the pants off of them. And we have two fine attorneys here who have been and are going to continue to do removal of pants from those people who violate church-state separation. We have Monica Miller and Dave Niose, both attorneys with the Appignani Humanist Legal Center, and you can read about them here. They have terrific backgrounds and successes in suing those violators. Dave is the legal director of the Appignani Humanist Center, and that's also where Monica works. And by the way, Dave's outstanding book, Nonbeliever Nation, is on sale outside as well. Monica has a terrific background. She received her master's in public administration in environmental science and policy and graduated cum laude from Vermont Law School and has had an outstanding legal career despite being young. And we know she'll continue her outstanding achievements. It's my pleasure to introduce both of them.
Thank you, Herb. I've heard more talk of losing pants at this conference than anything. You know what it is. It's crazy. But welcome, everyone. Good morning. It's great to see. What's that? Oh, the mic. Can you hear me? Okay. On Saturday morning at a Secular Student Alliance conference, you would never want the 9 a.m. talk. Because you know, the students are sleeping late, but it's great that we have such a turnout today for this talk. So we have a lot to cover. Yesterday, I think I had said 3 minutes wasn't enough to tell you about the Appignani Humanist Legal Center. Quite frankly, 45 minutes isn't enough either. We are so active and so busy doing so much, and we'll cover as much as we can, but I invite you to chat with us later as well. But before we start, don't you think Roy, Maggie, and the AHA have done a great job putting this conference together? It amazes me what they do. I don't know how they do it. I can't organize my own kid's birthday party, never mind a conference like this. And how they do it, it's beyond me. But thank you to them. Monica and I will be talking about the AHA's legal activism. And we'll break the time into two parts, basically. First, I'd like to give an overview of where the AHLC, Appignani Humanist Legal Center, is at this point in time and where it's heading. And I also want to talk about our equal protection strategy in some detail, because that was one of our busier cases this past year. After that, Monica will give an overview of some of our other cases, mostly First Amendment and Establishment Clause cases. So let me delve right into it with the limited time we have. As most of you know, the Appignani Humanist Legal Center was founded back in 2005. And of course, at that time, it was a startup with very limited activity, as would be expected. Quite frankly, the main activity early on was its newsletter that it would send out from time to time. If we were involved in lawsuits at all, it would usually be as an amicus party, which is really not a party at all, but a friend of the court. We would be submitting a brief, and quite frankly, we wouldn't even usually write the amicus briefs ourselves. We would sign on to amicus briefs done by others. And then the pace slowly picked up over the years. But now, quite frankly, we have lawsuits all over the country. state court, federal courts, and suits that we are handling in-house. Over the last year, year and a half, it's really picked up an awful lot. Monica and I are commencing suits. We're doing the discovery on the suits. We're negotiating the settlements, drafting the briefs, and arguing the motions. And quite frankly, as Monica will explain in a little bit, we're winning quite a few of them. We're really advancing the cause, and we're happy about that. And the AHA is getting known as a go-to litigation outfit, something that wasn't the case just even a few short years ago. Just by way of example, just recently, just this month, I got a call from a 17-year-old student on a church-state issue, a high school student calling the American Humanist Association thinking, you know, there's something that's not right in my school. Who do I call? The American Humanist Association. Isn't that wonderful? And this is because of not just the Legal Center, but the entire integrated activism of the American Humanist Association. Our social media is out there. We have over 250,000 followers on Facebook. And the, you know, as you know, Facebook is not reaching the geritol crowd, so to speak, right? Facebook is reaching younger people. We're reaching lots of younger people are hearing about the AHA, seeing what we're doing, and turning to us. The very next day after that 17-year-old called me, a 15-year-old girl called the Legal Center to complain about not being allowed to sit out the Pledge of Allegiance in her case. She's an atheist. She doesn't believe the nation is under God, doesn't want to participate, but she was being pressured. A 15-year-old girl calls the AHA saying, help me. Can you imagine that happening 10 years ago? I mean, the Legal Center wasn't even around. Right. I tell you, I haven't been so excited to get a call from a 15-year-old girl since I was a 15-year-old boy. And this is really where we're going. We have a higher profile as an organization and therefore as a legal outfit. We are more active and we're really trying to move on the right cases. We're trying to identify where we can advance the secular cause, so to speak, where we can firm up that wall of separation. And I'll tell you, in this environment, as I'll discuss in a little bit, it's not that easy. As you know, we do not have a judicial environment out there that is just welcoming church-state challenges with open arms. Far from it. But if we're selective and if we're smart in our strategy, we can do exactly that. So, with that in mind, I want to turn a little bit of attention to the equal protection strategy, which I assume many of you are familiar with, the AHA's pledge challenges over the last, the Massachusetts case is actually pending for about 3 years, and the New Jersey case is just getting off the ground. I'm going to give you a little bit of background on the theory behind it and how we came up with it. And then I know some of you have heard this before because I've talked about it for a while, but just for the benefit of those who aren't familiar with it. As most of you know, when most minority groups assert their rights in the courts, whether it's a racial minority, ethnic, or even women suing for sex discrimination, they usually use the avenue of equal protection, right? Just think of Brown versus Board of Education, the classic desegregation case. That's what they do. They go into court, they say, we are a minority group that's being discriminated against. We want equality, we want non-discrimination, and the courts, you know, assuming the case is there, grant it. But atheists and humanists have never pursued that avenue. Instead, we have gone under the theory of the Establishment Clause. But this has presented problems, especially in recent years. We have conservative federal courts that are kicking out cases just even based on standing, not even considering the substantive issue, but knocking us out on standing. We are faced with arguments about what George Washington and John Adams would think of this challenge. You know, what would the founders think of this? You never get that with equal protection cases, right? An African American sues for claiming racial discrimination. Nobody says, gee, what would George Washington think of this challenge, right? I don't know, maybe he'd ask his slaves. You know, and the same thing with sex discrimination, that sort of thing. also with the Establishment Clause. Another problem is that it's really not inherently an identity-oriented remedy. And just by way of example, consider that even a Christian can sue under the Establishment Clause to remove a Christian cross from public property just because the Christian believes in church-state separation. There's no real identity component to that. So we've been pursuing this avenue that's not the avenue that every other minority group seems to pursue. And so the question is, why not equal protection for atheists and humanists, right? Why not? Well, this is the approach we tried in Massachusetts. We filed a case under the State Equal Rights Amendment, which actually provides a higher level of equal protection than the federal constitution. It expressly forbids religious discrimination in its language in the constitution, something the federal constitution doesn't do, although it's supposed to do according to interpretation. Massachusetts has such high equal protection standards that it's the first state that legalized same-sex marriage with the Goodrich case back in 2003, granting same-sex marriage rights to gays and lesbians under equal protection theory under the state constitution. So we really thought that this would be the right place to go with this theory, bringing it forward, saying, hey, atheists and humanists are Americans too, right? Shouldn't we be treated with equality? We challenged the state statute that requires schools to conduct the Pledge of Allegiance exercise every day. The argument was very simple, that due to the under God affirmation in the Pledge of Allegiance, the exercise portrays God belief as synonymous with patriotism every single day for every child's 13-year public school career, so to speak. That obviously favors theism. It obviously disfavors non-theism. Isn't that discrimination? Well, it's really a very simple argument. I think I could go into any middle school and explain it to kids, and kids would, yeah, well, that's not really fair. And it's not. But unfortunately, the Massachusetts court, this liberal court in a liberal jurisdiction, the jurisdiction that gave us Goodrich, didn't agree. Kind of a sad day for atheists and humanists. They say the under God and the Pledge of Allegiance doesn't classify, it doesn't discriminate, even though it's led by teachers and its purpose is to instill patriotism every day for 13 years for a kid's career. In a backdrop of a society that holds well-documented anti-atheist prejudices, that's common knowledge, right? Everyone knows that. You may ask, well, why doesn't it discriminate? The court says, well, because it's voluntary. That's why it's voluntary, so it doesn't discriminate. The atheist kid can sit there and watch while her class conducts an exercise that marginalizes her belief and portrays her religious class as less patriotic than believers. Nothing discriminatory there, right? That was the logic, seriously. And the Chief Justice of the court wrote the opinion, an African-American man who voted in favor of Goodrich 9 years ago. The argument was almost surreal. One thing we pointed out in our brief is that the famous case of Loving versus Virginia back, I think it was 1967, which outlawed laws against interracial marriage. The side that was trying to argue in favor of statutes that forbid interracial marriage, they had this argument, well, interracial marriage prohibition laws don't discriminate because whites can't marry blacks, and blacks can't marry whites. There's no discrimination there. Well, that was the logic. Well, the same thing really was being made here. Well, believers can say the pledge or not say the pledge, and non-believers can say the pledge or not say the pledge. Nothing discriminatory. That was actually the logic used by the opposition in the court. And it was almost surreal. They also pointed to the fact that the plaintiffs were not bullied, as if that's a prerequisite for equal protection. Can you imagine if the pledge said we were one nation under Jesus, if Jews and Hindus objected to it, would the court say, well, you haven't been bullied yet. It doesn't discriminate until you come into court with a black eye, I guess. This is what we're up against. I think the lesson to be drawn from this case really is that we have a long way to go for atheist humanist equality in this country. We have not arrived as a movement. I think we like to think we have because we're so much further along than we were 10 years ago. But we haven't really arrived as a movement because despite what they say about justice being blind and politics being outside the realm of the judiciary, we all know that ain't true. Political acceptance is really a contingency upon which equal protection is granted in this country. If you're not recognized as a minority that deserves respect and that is widely seen as deserving a place at the table in the country, you're not going to get the equality that everyone else gets. As they say, some Americans are more equal than others, unfortunately. So going forward, what we plan to do is we are going to be more selective. We're going to learn from this experience. We are not going to drop this equal protection strategy at all. We believe identity-oriented atheist humanist activism is very important, but we do need to realize the unique nuances of the secular demographic as a movement. We are, in many ways, a privileged part of the American demographic, even though we are discriminated against. We drive to our atheist humanist local meetings in nice cars, and we live in nice houses, and we need to deal with that, and we need to assess it as we assess all of our activism. There's a lot to be learned from this case, a lot to be drawn from it. And we are also going to make sure next time we go into court that we have evidence of bullying, more evidence of bullying. These particular plaintiffs weren't bullied, but I'll tell you, there are a lot of kids out there, such as the 17-year-old boy and the 15-year-old girl who called us last month, who have in fact been bullied. And we'll be back. We're not going away. The same-sex marriage struggle had cases that were as disappointing as this one early on as well, but then along came other cases that were much more successful. So we will be back. That's the equal protection rundown in a nutshell, and I've probably taken too much time already, and Monica has a lot of stuff to discuss as well, because these equal protection cases are just two of numerous cases we have going on in the office. The culture wars are very much raging at the Appignani Humanist Legal Center as we do battle and try to remove the pants of many wrongdoers out there. So I'm going to turn the mic over to Monica Miller. Please welcome her.
It's nice to see you all here. As Dave mentioned, I will be talking mostly about our First Amendment lawsuits and that we really have had some victories. Although we've had some pushback with the equal protection cases, we've actually been relatively successful in our First Amendment cases, having only started this really litigation top shop, as Dave mentioned. One of our first victories was in California. We were suing the pants off of the city of Lake Elsinore, and they had a veterans memorial that contained a cross in the center of it, and a soldier was kneeling to the cross, and so we said, well, that's a violation of the Establishment Clause. We also said it was a violation of the California Constitution, which prohibits discrimination on the basis of religion, as well as you can't prefer one religion to another. So we brought the case in the Central District Court of California, and we first won our preliminary injunction, which basically the court said you cannot continue building this proposed veterans memorial. And then we went to sort of a mini trial after we filed for summary judgment, and the court ruled in our favor. One thing I found significant about this is generally when a court rules in your favor, they'll try to find just one ground to rule upon. He ruled on about three. He said, one, there was no secular purpose in the city adopting this memorial. There were statements that the city council members had made saying, I want the cross there, I'm taking a stand. So the court cited those instances and said, they're clearly putting this up to promote their own religious views. The second was that this obviously has a religious effect when you look at it. There's a cross on a monument on government property. The fact is that it's endorsing religion. And finally, the court ruled on our California Constitution claims, which we had brought several, all of which are sort of the equivalent of the federal establishment clause. But so, you know, the judge really went what I think is above and beyond, and really we won on a bunch of grounds, which I think from a precedent standpoint is good, because the next person that comes and wants to just bring a California state claim, now we've got a ruling that says this type of cross memorial violates the California Constitution. So that was our one of our major victories this year. Two others we reached very favorable settlements in. Both of them were school cases. The first one was in Mississippi, and that had to do with assemblies that they had students going to during homeroom, and they had kids from a local church giving lengthy presentations, I would call them sermons, about finding Jesus Christ. And each of the four assemblies they held concluded in a Christian prayer. And this was in public school, during school hours, completely unconstitutional. So we settled that case fairly quickly. The other one was also a school case. It was in Missouri, Fayette, Missouri. And there was a couple issues going on there, but the main one was that you had teachers basically praying with students in student clubs, and the teachers were promoting the student clubs through other flyers and that kind of thing. So we settled that one pretty quickly too, and definitely favorable to our direction. We have two other victories to talk about that are intermediary victories. We haven't won the whole case yet, but the first is a case, also a school case, coming out of South Carolina. And this is one where the school held fifth grade graduation ceremonies in a Christian church on the campus of a Christian university, and included two prayers in the graduation ceremony, one at the beginning and one at the end. And they've been doing this apparently for about 50 years, ever since the school's opened. So I'm very grateful. We had two very brave parents that came to us. They are anonymous, but gosh, it's tough in the South. And so we filed for an injunction, as we do in a lot of these cases, and we lost. And we lost really unfairly. We had a judge that was extremely biased, as Dave was alluding to earlier. We are facing some very judges that do not want to hear these cases. He was so biased that when we appealed our preliminary injunction, the Fourth Circuit agreed with us that we deserve a new judge. And I think that's a very extraordinary remedy to reappoint a judge, because they're so biased. So although the case is not yet finished and we're still litigating it, we are about to get a new judge that hopefully will not be as biased towards atheists and humanists. So I consider that at least an interim victory. And finally, one that's made a lot of media attention that you might have heard about is our lawsuit in Carroll County, Maryland, that has to do with legislative prayers being said. And this was a victory at first, because we were able to obtain a preliminary injunction enjoining Carroll County, Maryland, from delivering prayers in the name of Jesus and Savior at their council, their county board meetings. And I think that this is also a victory because the judge really didn't need to rule at all in our favor. I mean, he didn't have to rule at all, period, because the Town of Greece case that many of you probably know about was currently pending. And he probably could have decided to wait just until the court ruled. But he found our argument persuasive that at the time, at least, that this was going on, it was unconstitutional under the Fourth Circuit cases. So we did obtain a preliminary injunction in that case as well. We are now in the middle of summary judgment for the decision. We are making a lot of arguments as to why the Town of Greece case that just came down is different from our case. I mean, for one thing, we have county board members delivering prayers as opposed to outside citizens, laypersons, clergy. We have board members and the board president or the mayor delivering prayers. So I think that is far more egregious. And then we have a lot of pending matters, too. I'll just try to run through those fairly briefly. One of our other high-profile lawsuits is a challenge to a large Christian cross on a government median in Bladensburg, Maryland. We say that that's a violation of the Establishment Clause because it's a large cross on government property. It's kind of hard not to see how that would be unconstitutional. We have another case out in Oregon. We're representing a federal prisoner whom the Bureau of Prisons denied him the ability to meet with fellow humanists in a group setting, which is what they allow most of the other religious groups to do. And I'm talking, you know, the pagans and the Druids. They have groups for minority religions, so it's not... we're contending that that's also a violation of equal protection principles because the denial is based off of his religious views. And so that's kind of an example of where that kind of strategy is used. But we're using the federal Fifth Amendment's equal protection, which is a little different than a state one. Another case that we have going on, I think Dave mentioned it yesterday as well, was a lawsuit in Pennsylvania, and we're representing United Coalition because they were denied the ability to run a bus ad that says, I forget the slogan, but you know, good without God, or I forget what it said, something along the lines of, you know, you can, had atheists in it, I guess. But anyways, the Transportation Authority did not want to run that ad, so we are currently suing pants off of them under free speech principles. So just, it goes to show that not all of our cases are Establishment Clause. This is a just totally free speech case. And I guess that's really it for the Establishment Clause First Amendment cases that I'll be talking about today.
Thank you. Would you, if you have questions, please line up at the microphone. And I notice there are a lot of lawyers in the audience, so this is specifically directed to you, though it applies to everyone. Please ask brief questions, not make long statements.
My question, is this on?
Yes, yeah. It is. We hear you.
On the New Jersey case, is there a statute that also, like the Massachusetts statute, the Equal Protection Clause, specifically addresses the religious, there has to be religious equal protection?
Yes, there is. There's a state statute requiring recitation of the Pledge of Allegiance, as there was in Massachusetts, and there is constitutional language expressly forbidding religious discrimination. So, in that sense, the short answer is yes. There are little differences between the two. One nice thing about the New Jersey statute is it expressly states the words of the Pledge of Allegiance, just in case you weren't sure. It expressly says that, you know, that the children shall recite each morning. Then it has the entire pledge with the under God wording in the statute, which the Massachusetts statute did not have. Not that that was a real big factor in the case.
Well, I'm so glad you're not trying to go into federal courts under the 14th Amendment equal protection.
That's exactly, that's the
because
strategy.
You would get an adverse decision, I'm sure, from
right,
the Supreme Court.
And that's why we're doing it the way we're doing it.
On church-state issues, to what degree do you cooperate with the ACLU, or if both are contacted by an aggrieved party, how do you decide who proceeds, that sort of thing?
I don't think we've had any cases where we've been approached simultaneously, but we cooperate with the with other groups. Not just the ACLU, but any other groups, really on a case-by-case basis. It's not very competitive. There's more of a cooperative spirit between the various groups that are interested in a progressive view of church-state separation.
Yeah, I have a similar question. I'm kind of wondering about your caseload versus the resources, and then, of course, other organizations like Freedom From Religion Foundation and other groups that are, you know, kind of, how do you determine which organization litigates the case?
Well, we take cases that we're approached about. It's not like people approach us all and then we speak with the ACLU, FFRF, or other groups, and that we decide amongst ourselves who takes it. They come to us and we decide whether, number one, we think the case is strong enough and whether it's smart for us to pursue it, and then whether we have the resources to pursue it. So it's really just a matter of assessment of each case that comes along. We get inquiries all the time, almost daily. We get inquiries, emails from people who, you know, have a gripe about this or have a complaint about this or may just have a general question. Not many of them actually end up being cases, although we do quite a bit of what we call pre-litigation work as well, where we just send a letter out to the school system and warn them that if they don't stop doing what they're doing, they are going to be sued. And quite frequently, that warning letter alone will suffice.
Thanks.
Sorry, the previous gentleman already asked my question.
Yeah, it seems to me that whenever the topic of the Pledge of Allegiance and the public... Okay, can you hear me?
Yep.
It seems to me that whenever the topic of the Pledge of Allegiance comes up, the focus is always on students and never on teachers and administrators who, as far as I know, probably don't have the option to opt out of the pledge. So have you ever had atheist teachers or administrators complaining about this? Can they be used as plaintiffs as opposed to the students?
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
All right, great. We haven't had any teachers directly coming to us, but my assumption is that a court would be way more inclined to rule in our favor with the students just because they are more susceptible to coercion and to bullying and that kind of thing. I mean, just based on our experience in Massachusetts, it seems we wouldn't have as much success with an adult. Based also just on the recent Town of Greece case, the court talked a lot about how adults are different from children with respect to coercion. So,
do you think that the ruling in the Massachusetts situation was based on the court being fearful of the outcome if they had ruled in your favor? Whenever you hear bizarre arguments from people who you know better, as we've seen in politics, it usually means they're hiding something. They're afraid of something. They're making excuses and hoping that they're going to get by, like Governor Christie with a lot of his excuses and things. So if they had ruled against you and basically said the pledge as it stands is unconstitutional, I'm sure there would have been a tremendous amount of backlash. Do you think that they were just basically taking the easy way out politically?
I mean, absolutely. I think that was what Dave was alluding to earlier, that we are not there as a movement. I think the judges are very sensitive to how politics are and how people are perceived. And I actually read a law review or an article that the Chief Justice wrote after the Goodrich case, and he talked about getting death threats from people that were opposed to same-sex marriage. And I'm not saying that that's, you know, maybe he was acting out of fear, but I'm certain that the fear of what ramifications it would have for them socially or politically was a factor.
I would have to agree with that. I think the political momentum is really a necessity if you're going to be going in saying that a long, well-established practice has to change, especially something that hits a patriotic nerve like the Pledge of Allegiance. If you're going to be doing that, I think you really need to have political momentum. It transcends the judiciary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So at least you still forced him to have to come to grips with the situation. And, I mean, he was caught in a vice where he couldn't win either way, right? So at least he had to basically make himself look foolish in terms of trying to do something with it.
Right.
We have about 10 minutes left, so no more people, please, get in line, but you will have opportunities to talk to our fine lawyers afterward.
Thank you. My first question is for Dave. Could you explain what you mean by we have to come to terms with our privilege, the nice houses, the nice cars?
Sure. What I mean is that when minority groups claim discrimination, a word that usually soon follows is oppression. That there's some sort of serious social economic disadvantage due to the discrimination that they're talking about. The classic example, obviously, is racial discrimination. I mean, they ended slavery, but it did, Jim Crow continued, and African Americans, even today, are still experiencing economic disadvantage because of that. And it's obvious, we can see, and it doesn't take a lot of academic assessment to realize that this is a social and economic reality. We see with women, we see the glass ceiling, and there's lots of statistics showing that they earn, 60-70% of what men earn, and that there's an obvious real economic disadvantage due to discrimination. Our demographic, overall, on average, are better off economically than the typical American. And that's one of the things that Phil Zimmerman from Pitzer College, that's his name, right?
Zuckerman
from Pitzer College, he has this great sociological study showing how atheists and humanists are actually less prone to social ills than most other groups. So we are very much, in many ways, privileged. There's one real area where we could claim oppression, if you will, although that's a strong word, but it's the realm of politics. In pop culture and society in general, there's not a whole lot of prejudice against atheists. It's out there, but it's not permeating society and making our lives miserable. What it is when you enter the realm of politics, suddenly there's a fence of piety around everything. And we somehow have to show that area and other areas where we may be experiencing discrimination adds up to something real that society should care about.
So it's not enough just to be discriminated against?
Well, it's an interesting question, and I'm not necessarily saying that it doesn't matter, but what I'm saying is that to outsiders looking in, they say, what are you atheists complaining about? It's only under God. It's only in God we trust on money. We can point to that University of Minnesota study that shows that atheists are the most disliked, most distrusted demographic, the demographic that people would least want their children to marry into. That's all in this study. I'm talking about it as if you have heard of it already, but I'm sure many of you have. But we can point to that, but it still doesn't always add up to oppression that people are going to recognize as real.
Well, please. Thank you.
You could say, well, what would the founding fathers do? They would go to their mansions and their acres of property and decide about this. But just a quick one. Normally, the term atheist.
Okay, can we just go to the next one because we're kind of short on time? Thank you. And incidentally, we're also better educated, which helps us more economically advantage.
My question is, as I recall, correct me, Freedom from Religion ill-advisedly brought a case to the Supreme Court, which they lost and cost standing. I'm wondering how that is playing out. Or is the standing problem a problem?
The standing problem is definitely a problem. We actually have not yet lost a case on standing grounds, but that's because we look at Tahine and we look to some of these other cases. I think you're referring to Tahine v. Freedom from Religion. We look to those cases and we try to find a way to get around them, find plaintiffs locally. And that does bar us from bringing cases that we would otherwise think are good cases. And I think that just goes back to being careful, carefully selecting what cases we bring, even outside of the standing realm, just to be sure that we're not creating bad precedent, because precedent's extremely important in, willy-nilly bringing cases. And I'm not saying FFRF did that, but I'm just saying bringing cases without trying to see a little bit further than the case is really important for us. Thank you.
You may have addressed this at the beginning. I missed the first few moments of the thing today. You might have addressed this already at the very beginning, but I come out of Jehovah's Witnesses, and so my children, when they went to school, we had to go and tell the teacher, that this has been fought in the courts, and they do not have to recite the Pledge of Allegiance or anything. And it really went fairly easily, although kids, they learned to be different. And I guess I don't understand why that previous court decision that Jehovah's Witnesses fought for us, that why that doesn't hold here.
If I understand your question, are you referring to the Barnett case that says that nobody has to say the Pledge of Allegiance? Is that what you...
I don't know who the litigants were because it was before I ever even became involved, which was many, many years ago. But I know that they did get a court ruling that you did not have to...
Right. If I understand your question correctly, you're wondering why the schools aren't honoring that case. And that's exactly the point we're making with these pledge cases, not the equal protection challenges, but when a child comes to us and says that his or her school is forcing the student to participate in the pledge exercise, you're right, it's that Barnett case that means we win. Obviously, the schools are not either not aware of the Barnett case or choosing to ignore it, because you're absolutely right, the Supreme Court is on our side and on the student's side on those issues. Those cases are extremely strong cases. The equal protection cases we have are more esoteric, and we're bringing a new argument. We're trying to kind of change the law, or at least to create some new precedent. Barnett cases are slam dunks. They are, we will win every one that we bring, no question about it. And in fact, that's one thing that we actually want to do more of in the AHA. Again, this integrated activism, not just the legal center, but the AHA as an organization, I think, is going to be paying more attention to students' rights not to participate in the pledge and to educate students about that. And maybe that will generate more legal activism, which will generate more.
No time for follow-ups. I'm sorry. We have about 2 minutes left.
Now, so, yeah.
It's hard to argue against the strategy of an identity-based strategy. But does it give you any reservations that it seems to link ideology to identity the way the religious do?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, but I don't think it's ideology. I never think of humanism as an ideology. I think of it as a very pragmatic philosophy.
It would be perceived by others that way.
What's that?
I mean, it would be perceived by others that way, that we're sort of reinforcing religious argumentation.
Well, I don't really see it that way. I think we're not trying to force our religious views, if you will. I know some people don't like to call it, but our views on religion. We're not trying to force that on other people. There is some necessity for public education and for good public communication to make it clear to people that we're not trying to make America an atheist country. That we're, some people say that if we remove under God from the pledge, suddenly we're making the pledge pro-atheist. No, we're not. Pro-atheist would be one nation under no gods, indivisible. So by removing it, it's basically a question of educating people about the difference between neutrality and favoritism. And I think if we are effective in communicating that, it shouldn't be a problem.
Hi. Recently, my middle school boys had a problem in their school where they were called out publicly in front of the class for refusing to stand for the pledge. And so what I did was I researched different letters that had been written by different organizations and kind of put together my own letter to send to the school. I have a good relationship with the school, and I didn't want to resort, first to legal defense. And also, I know you guys are super busy. So my question is, for cases like that, especially when it's just a matter of education and the school would do the right thing if it were called to their attention, do you have a model generic letter that kind of just informs the school of what is and what isn't that parents can go to and send?
I mean, we have a couple letters that we've sent out to schools for those situations. But, I would recommend that anyone that has that situation you just described, someone getting called out in class for not saying the pledge or for sitting out, I would say contact us just to let us know about it if you feel comfortable with that, because these are kind of, especially as Dave mentioned earlier, we basically lost our case because we didn't show bullying. I mean, there was a lot of other factors, but that was the written explanation that they gave us. And I think for us to know about these instances, I think is important, but we could, work on some sort of form letter we can put online perhaps. But we do have some letters we've sent already. If people want to send a letter with their own name and want to use, some of the language we've used, we can certainly help you with that as well.
Okay, thank you.
We would like to have relationships with families that have experienced this, though, so please do contact us and let us know about it.
Okay, well, I've been in contact with Monica before about a case that she handled for our case, so for our group, so I'll do that.
Thank you.
And thank all the questioners and our panel.